With the sudden death of the late Emperor of Rhûn, the different lords of Rhûn city-states have burst into an open civil war. Yet there can only be one Emperor, the Golden Dragon of Rhûn, Lôke-Khan Rhûkar. The rightful heir to the throne now seeks to strike down the rebelling servants of his assassinated father, for all of them crave the power of the Dragon Throne. Rhûn and its empire's former territory are an absolutely gigantic region. The Sea of Rhûn only marking the very westernmost edge of this mighty amalgamation of confederated city-states. While the east of Rhûn is largely controlled by Lôke-Heru Yasur, a loyal ally to the imperial family, the western half of the once united territory has now been thrown in utter chaos and upheaval ever since the last Lôke-Khan died. Civil revolts against Melkor's shadow in the eastern lands, rumored to be caused by some blue wizards, demand Yasur's attention. Thus, Rhûkar needs to deal with a few petty traitors himself. The wealthy city of Mistrand, Rhûn's capital under the light of the golden sun dragon Kar, is the Lôke-Khan seat of power, and it is from here that the dragon cult seeks to unite all the people of Rhûn. First, we should re-establish our trade routes with our allies in Mordor and Khand. The cities of Mattaram and Enmahadh have recently been overrun by Variag deserters, trying to carve their own piece of Middle-earth for themselves. Pathetic. We shall teach them what it means to anger the dragon, and show them that they were better off serving Variag Khan Arkish. To our west lies Bur Ermanarikis, Balchoth territory in days long gone, where the highly esteemed Lôke-Heru Zosh has finally revealed his decade-old sinister intentions about claiming the throne to the world. He managed to sway many Claw Legionnaires, and even worse, members of the Dragonwrath Order. These men are fierce opponents. What they lack in numbers, they make up for in equipment and stalwartness. To the north lie the lands of the Arulad, who have seized the inner turmoil in our empire as an opportunity to declare their independence in the cities of Elgair and Rhûbar. Fools! The dragon riders of the Arulad have always been respected members of the Glittering Horde, and they would dare throw it all away? No. They will be punished and forced back in line. Beating down this rebellion and proclaiming Rhûkar as rightful ruler of all of Rhûn will be but the beginning of our journey. To silence any doubts about the Qarrish dynasty being destined to lead the Golden Empire, we shall prove our might by reclaiming our long-lost lands west of the sea, now home to the Dorwinrim. The wealthy Iron Hills to the north will provide much-needed resources to outfit our legionnaires for our upcoming conquests. The dwarves who inhabit these keeps will either join us in service or suffer the consequences of their stubbornness. If their allies, the men of Dale, would try to stop that, the wrath of the dragon will burn their cities, as it has done once before. When the time comes that our Dark Lord Sauron calls upon our aid to fulfill his conquest of Middle-earth, we shall join him, for we have no love for the men of Gondor and Rohan, nor the elves who should have left these lands while they had the chance. Still, our aspirations and ambitions are our own, and we should only serve Sauron for as long as it benefits us. But for now, we shall march out and restore the Empire of Rhûn. The Golden Horde shall trample all those that would dare oppose us. Submit, or face the wrath of the Golden Dragon. Greetings, my friends, and welcome back to Third Age Total War Divide and Conquer. We are once again playing with the AI and Gameplay Overhaul Submod, or AGO, developed by Fynn, as well as the Empire of Rhûn Submod developed by Baking Bread, or Arktos. You can find all the links you need to play this mod in the description of this video. With Rhûn being my favourite faction in all of Middle-earth, it was a no-brainer that I would feature this amazing Submod on the channel next. I don't want to waste too much time, but before I jump into the campaign, I would be so straightforward to ask for your support on this video. As you know, I don't run any ads or sponsorships, nor do I have a Patreon or anything like that. This way I can keep the ads to a minimum, without having to worry about cutting out copyrighted material or music, and thus making these videos as good as I can possibly make them, without forcing you to play Raid Shadow Legends. In exchange, I would be very, very grateful if you could give this video a like and leave a comment as well. Your support, especially on a first episode, helps me more than you could realize. If you haven't subscribed yet, I'm not sure what you're waiting for. As always, we'll be playing on very hard difficulty with the Palantir House Rule, though I'm not sure if we'll get one anytime soon. Special thanks to Fynn and Arktos for making this mod, and I also want to give a quick shout out to my buddy Frozenstack for being a fantastic sounding board. Check out his channel for more DAC and other content in the description. Without further ado, we've got ourselves an empire to reform. Alright, welcome to the campaign side of things. The Empire of Rhûn submod for Divide and Conquer AGO version 2. Now, if you are new to Divide and Conquer or you're new to AGO, then this is a very interesting thing to read, but, well, I'm not, because we did our Reunited Kingdom campaign in AGO as well, so none of this is really new to me. What is new, however, is the specific stuff about the Empire of Rhûn submod. Here's a bit of the reasoning of kind of the idea behind the mod, so if you want to read through that, go ahead. But what I'm mostly interested in are the changes. The Tribe Confederation of the Easterlings of Rhûn is transformed into the Empire of Rhûn. So back in regular Divide and Conquer, and even in AGO, it's not about beating down rebellions, it's more about just reuniting separate tribes. In this case, we're dealing with a civil war, pretty much, so kind of the idea is a little bit different, which I kind of like that a lot more than Rhûn being just one region, which it doesn't really make a lot of sense in the lore. So I like it more that there's a civil war and we need to crush any dissidents to reunite our empire. Rhûn's military is transformed into a powerful standing army, the Golden Host, that encompasses three tiers. Legionnaires, the Lokrim, and the Dragon Wrath Order. So no more Baltshoth trash and Daritai suckers. We are now a professional army, pretty much on tier with the likes of Gondor and Dol Amroth and even the Northern Dunedain. So that's something I'm very much looking forward to. Rhûn's improved units take, of course, longer to replenish than before, and they are held back by enormous upkeep and recruitment costs. We kind of balance our strength with our cost, that makes sense. Fire is a staple in the military, I like the sound of that. Rhûn's roster was given a single unified look that brings its appearance closer to the movies, I love that a lot. We can also subjugate or press into service warriors of Harad and Khant once the requirements are met. Flavor text and event messages were edited to match both the new story and Rhûn's self-perception, which is of course that we have Magnum Dongs and we are the greatest people in all of Middle-earth. Right, backstory, okay. And yeah, big thanks to the makers of the mod and to me as well for playing it, right? No message there. That's a shame. Alright, the Golden Dragon takes flight. If you watch the intro, which I assume most of you have, then most of this will seem familiar to you. I will scroll through it ever so slowly, in case you want to pause and read through it to yourself. But it is, it's a lot of text. I didn't really make this quite literally the intro. I pulled out some bits and bobs, made it a little bit shorter, added some of my own flair, which I'm very well known for at this point. But the main idea is reflected in the intro. Alright, and here we are. Now we are let go by the developers, and it's our little sandbox that we can go and kill whoever, wherever we want. Now, those of you who've been on the channel for a longer time probably remember that about a year ago, in December of 2020, I did a special live stream for when I hit 10k subs, and I did an entire Rhûn campaign in one go. It took me about 22 hours, and it really killed my sleep schedule for about a week. Unfortunately, there is no video of that, because the stream was simply too long for YouTube to handle it. But I do have some experience with how to play Rhûn, as opposed to many other campaigns I have done. And the one thing I remember being very important for any Rhûn campaign is to take Mattaram, which is this sort of Khandis region, up about here first, because it has access to pretty much part of the Orokani dwarven mines and industry, and it just makes you a lot of money. But before we do that, we should probably send our spy, because I can already tell by Lest that garrisons are quite a bit beefier than they are in vanilla. So we got Kagi the Clever. Oh, there we go, that's a wall of text. Maybe we'll read through that at some point. But for now, I'm going to send you in the direction of Mattaram. Tell me, what do your Easterling eyes see? Okay, so we have some Khandish raiders, Khandish hunters. I think that's the same garrison as it is in vanilla, and we got Kustik, who has Variag nobles, who are one of the few, if not only, armor-piercing horse archer units. Damn, I can't speak. 3 weeks of not recording has killed my ability to speak. And here you have already three new units. Yes, noble man. Let's just go through our guys real quick. We got Lokheru Margos. We got Khan Amdur, Lord of Blades. I love these names. And then we have Lôke-Khan Rhûkar the Golden. There we go. Biography, in case you want to read that. That might be an intro at some point. Okay. So what have we got here? We got the Runic Fang Legion, which seems to be our basic, and I use the term basic quite loosely. You get 7 attack and 11 defense. That is very, very good for the basic unit. But sort of sword and board unit. So they're part of the Fang Legion, which I think also has a spear variant, the Runic Claw Legion. So we got Fang and Claw. 5 attack, so less attack than the sword guys, but more defense. And also skill against mounts. So that's going to be very useful against Khand. Okay. Bonus against camels, wargs, and horses. They don't like snow, makes sense. Then we also have the Runic Fire Legion. Oh, that's awesome. Who are pretty much knockoff Lok-Narim. They're a bit cheaper to get, a bit more readily available. But they still pack quite a punch. 4 missile attack is quite high for a unit with 127 archers. 5 melee attack, which is also pretty good. And 8 defense, mostly armor. Okay, let's see. 200 meters range. That is quite respectable. I think most first tier archers are like 180 or something like that. And high accuracy as well. 30 missiles, also quite a lot. And they use flaming arrows already. So even our lowest tiered archers use flame arrows, which is quite amazing. Any other units here? No. We do have the general units. We got Lokheru Margos. I'll let you read through the biography in case you're interested. He's got Lok-Narim, so they are the better archers. 9 melee attack, that's quite a bit more. 5 missile attack, that's only one more. But they are armor piercing, that's a big one, that's new. 14 defense. Very high accuracy. Less range than the Fire Legion, which is a bit surprising. They burn targets and pierce, and they got Dragonfire arrows. So not regular arrow, but Dragonfire. Yes, then we got Khan Amdur, who is our Khan, so I assume our heir, right? Let's see. This general was truly lucky. I thought maybe that was the... Is he the heir? We'll check our family tree in a moment. He's got Dragon Knight, which is a cavalry unit, with 12 attack, 13 charge, that is incredibly high, and 30 defense. That is almost, we only have 10 of them, that's almost Royal Swan Guard tiers of just awesomeness. And then we have Lôke-Khan Rhûkar, who I think has, I need to move you out. I think he has Dragon Knights as well, right? Yes. Only 10 of them, which is not a whole lot, but we can probably get some traits to, boost that a little bit. Alright, let's check out our family tree. How do you do that again? It's been so long. There we go. So, okay, we got Lôke-Khan Rhûkar. He's married to Mareke, I think. Our quote-unquote son is Khan Amdur. He's married to Kuzu. We got a daughter, Tikkis. And we got 2 sons, who are actually already quite old, 14 and 12. So they mature in, well, just a couple turns at age 16. So that's 2 generals we'll have relatively soon. And these guys, they'll take a little bit longer. Mukalku and Marwan. Let's see. We need to hold 32 regions, which is not that many. Including Mistrand. We already have that. Erebor and Dale. Okay, so nothing about Dorwinion. So we're kind of free to deal with them. Oh, no, wait. We need to eliminate them. We don't need to hold their capital. Not Karasand. But we need to eliminate them. So we need to eliminate Gondor, which is going to be the ones that most far away from us. Erebor, Dale, and Dorwinion. So kind of natural victory conditions. Makes sense. That's what I'd aim for anyway. So I think what we're going to do, first and foremost, how expensive are you? 350 upkeep. These guys, 750 recruit, 250 upkeep. I assume it's the same for all of them. Yes. So I'm thinking, do I send... I mean, I definitely want to send the Lok-Narim to do a siege battle. So I'm going to move you out. Plop down a watchtower, why not? I love watchtowers. And I'm kind of thinking, do I need Khan Amdur? In an offensive siege, I feel like Dragon Knights aren't going to be that useful, and it would save me 350 upkeep, so I'm going to put him in the fort. You guys... You could already lay siege to Mattaram. Interesting. Can you reach in the next turn? You can, okay. So you meet up with them. And then these guys, the ones that don't get free upkeep, definitely join. So now we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 guys. They've got 8 as well. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. But we are better, right? They're filthy horse riders. We are proud men of Rhûn. I don't think I need anyone else. It saves me 250, 500 for both. So yeah, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to leave them for free upkeep for now. I could pick up some mercenaries. Nothing too interesting, though. Faroon mercenaries, I quite like them. Ruffians and sellswords. We only have one settlement, so that kind of makes our building pretty easy. I could already get some runic dragon riders. They're skilled against mounts. That's quite good, actually. An anti-cavalry cavalry unit. 3 attack, that's very low. But 10 charge and 12 defense. So they kind of make up for it. You don't want to leave him in prolonged melee. Although they are skilled against mounts. So I think they're very much a charge in against other cav, then pull out charging against other cav as well. Just again and again and again. But what do I want to build in Mistrath? There's so many good buildings to get. Let's see. We got lots of governor's influence, lots of law, lots of garrison bonus. So we don't need to worry about public order at all. Our growth is pretty healthy as well. 20k to upgrade it to what I assume to be a large city, yes. Our income is mostly farming. Well, first things first, we want to get a diplomat. I don't think we have a diplomat yet. How do I check that? Lists, agents? No, we only have our spy. And do I have any trade rights? Okay, we do have trade rights with Khand and with Mordor. I think it might not be a bad idea, because we start out at war with Gondor, Erebor, and Dale, not with Dorwinion, to get trade rights with Dorwinion, so they can kind of finance my troops that I will then use against them at some point. And I think I want to expand more and more into trade, because what I remember from playing my Rhûn campaign is that once you control all the settlements surrounding the Sea of Rhûn, you can get so much trade with yourself going on, it really just boosts the bank like crazy. So I'm doubting, do I get a grain exchange? What's a nomadic gathering grounds? What does that do? These encampments have enough space to allow the many horsemen of Khan to train. Okay, so we can train some Khanish troops once we subdue them, I assume. Ballista maker could be useful to get a ballista early on. It's a little bit expensive, takes too long. Way station, that's to retrain AOR units. Leather tanner, armor upgrades. Mason's Hall could be good to get in the early game as well, just to speed everything else up. Only 2 turns. A port, that's 6 turns. Grain exchange 3, very cheap, and it does give you a nice bonus. Wait, it doesn't show it? Oh, because I don't have any trade yet. I see. I think I can also get, once I get the grain exchange, I think I can get a bazaar as well. Maybe a camel trading post. Just the extra trade buildings. And I can also get merchants. A great hall allows me to train dragon knights, which is my general's. So that's my basic general's bodyguard, I assume. That's quite OP. I think we'll go for the Mason's Hall. Right, anything else I need to do? I'm always like feeling like I'm forgetting something. Oh, we got the faction info. That's probably something very important to read through. Dragon relics. You need to send a diplomat to Esgaroth if you're not at war with Dale. A diplomat to Bjorn's Hall. We're already at war with them. Bjorn's Hall with the Anduin Vale. And a spy to Anazanar. If you're at war with the factions, you can only take the artifacts by force, capturing the settlements. I think we'll get another scroll about that in the next turn. End the civil war. You need to crush rebellions against your rule by defeating their leaders and capturing their key settlements, unlocking units for training. For Khandish auxiliaries and Haradrim mercenaries, you need Mattaram, which is here, and Enmahadh, which is roughly here. For access to Lôke-Inazrim and Lôke-Narim, you need Rhûbar and Elgaer, which are here and here. For any Dragon Wrath units, not sure what that's all about, you need Bur Ermanarikis, which is here. For ships and runes fire units, ooh, you need Lust. And finally, conquer Dorwinion's lands after all the other settlements to complete the script and unite the Empire, unlocking very powerful units to train in runic heartlands. That sounds like our first go for like the first couple 10 episodes or something like that. Ring script. After capturing the ring, you will get a message to bring the ring to the Black Gate. Okay. So we just bring it back to Sauron. We don't have our own special ring script or anything.
If you don't interfere and the ring is on a good faction, it might be destroyed. It can fail in the process, at which point Sauron will get it. If it's on a faction with allegiance to Isengard, which is realistically only Dunland and possibly Enedmwaith, it will go to them. If it's on an ally of Mordor, it will go to them. Sometimes an AI faction will choose to keep the ring instead. I do very much like this new ring script. And then establishing spy networks. If we put our spy in the faction capital, starting capital, then we can get a spy network there and get a message in case any general of that specific faction holds the one ring. Okay, I think that's all. Let's press the enter. I did jump this into this pretty blind. I've only just gotten back from my vacation. I was just like, I want to play this game. I've missed it for so much. I'm probably going to sound incredibly rusty, and listening to myself, I do sound incredibly rusty, and I have a hard time getting my words out. But it's a matter of getting back into it, you know. We'll get there, we'll get there. Especially once we've got the first battle on our hands. I'll be back to spitting insults and just being downright horrible to other factions, as I do. Alright. I'm not sure what our goal is for the first episode. I'm not sure how long these first battles will take. I guess a good goal would be to make money. Because right now I'm hemorrhaging money. Alright, our great nation appears weak to tolerate such insolence from these rebels. So we need to capture Mattaram and we'll be rewarded with a military unit. I was going to do that even without the reward. How can I get a boat? Oh, I can only recruit it from a coastal tower. So if I'm walking here, I can get a boat. Honestly, that might be interesting, because I can only recruit ships when I take less, which will still take a while. But if I can get a quick boat now, I don't think they're very expensive in upkeep. 100, like that's not going to make a difference. I could scout this place, I forgot the name. Oh, what is it? There's a settlement here. Naburka. Oh, Darwinian starts with Naburka. Uh-huh. I thought it was a rebel settlement. Okay, but I can scout Elgair. Ooh, they got some scary units. They got Loklarim, which look like a halberd unit. They got lots of them. They got Bori. They got Lok-Inazrim. Interesting. I mean, I could already gather an army to take Enmahadh as well. I'll send my spy over. Follow the road, would ya? By the Nine Divines, stay on route. Okay, so that's a very similar army to the one we're seeing in Mattaram. Okay. My finances are not looking great. Our units are so expensive. But we do have a diplomat now, which I'm going to send towards Darwinian. They should have Strondost here, I think. Yes. Hello, Fourth Wind. You're looking quite pleasant. Trade rights. I could ask for map information.
This proposal is of little interest.
Okay, no. Whoa, wait. I don't want to give you money. Just trade rights.
You hold us at ransom until we meet again.
Still losing money? I don't think it has changed yet.
Yes,
where should I send my diplomat next? Dol Guldur, I suppose. Unless, hang on a moment. Dragon relic. Send diplomat to Bjorn's Hall. I could send him to Bjorn's Hall and he could get the relic, because we're not at war with them. And he can pass through Dol Guldur at the meantime. Talk to my good friend Kamul. I have reason to believe these guys are going to sally out. Not sure if they will. It'd be in their best bet, though, because they use cavalry a lot. Then we'll shoot them and burn them. And we got spears. We'll be fine. Don't think I need to do anything else. You do some more scouting. That's quite useful, actually. Alright. Come on them. Attack me, so I can drag my dragon balls all over your face. Oh, Lord. Oh, hello there. Leave me alone. It's good to be back, though. I missed this game. The moment I started up the game, and I was loading from the campaign menu into the campaign, and I heard a specific track. I don't know the name of it. I think they played in the movie during Lothlorien, and it just filled me with this great sense of, oh, what the hell's going on? Nostalgia. I can't look at it because Tickiss is in the way, and I can't close it because I can't use my mouse. I think this is just explaining the Dragon Relic script. Can you get out of the way for a moment? Yeah, Relics of the Dragons. Scattered across the Middle-earth are relics of the great dragons, created by Morgoth and unleashed during the War of Wrath. These mighty beings gave even the Valar cause for fear. Now with both the Valar and Morgoth gone, the dragons remain, somewhat, and it is to these gods we sacrifice. For after all, what good are the Valar and Morgoth when they are either gone forever or do not care? Whereas the dragons are here, and these relics are proof of that. If we were able to acquire some of these relics, the reach of the dragon cult would expand, and more clans from the east would fall under its sway. We should send our diplomat into the Vale of Anduin to Bjorn's Hall, where remnants of the famous Skathas Horde are located, and to the lands of Kingdom of Dale, where Smaug's corpse lays in the Long Lake near the lake city of Esgaroth, slain by the heretic Bard, and try to acquire these artifacts. We should also send our spy into the cold north of the Withered Heat, where we may be able to find an egg left by our gods. If our diplomats and spies fail in acquiring these artifacts, we can turn to our influence among the military's officers and launch campaigns to conquer these settlements. That won't be for any time soon, but it will be very much a goal. Oh, the garrison of Lust is kind of threatening me a little bit. It's a large garrison. Can't you harass Dorwinian, please? Anyway, enough talking. They didn't sally out, which is very much their mistake. Because I'm going to shoot the shit out of you, Acoustic. Ooh, look at his model on the campaign map. That looks quite cool. Not sure why he's in all black. He kind of looks like an Unsullied from Game of Thrones. A little bit. Battle Power is very much in my favor, and that's because he has horse archers, which the game doesn't really like so much in the Balance of Power. They always rate them pretty low. But this army is quite scary, because all of these units are archers. So they're all going to shoot me. I do have a range advantage, about 30 meters to these guys. The horse archers typically have shorter range, yes. So, I think we're going to be alright. I am going to save. Not over my Reunited Kingdom campaign. We need a new save title. There we go. Yeah, without further ado, let's grab our first settlement.
We shall all find a way to an honorable victory!
Holy shit, how good these guys look. Let's just appreciate them for a moment. Let's start with the Runic Fire Legion. Not quite as cool as the Lôke-Khan, I remember, but... Look at them, especially the way their armor looks. In vanilla DAC, the gold they wear is kind of a little bit gaudy, a little bit too much. Whilst here it's more bronze-like. It's less flashy and more tempered a little bit, which I do very much like. And the helmets also look incredible. So let's compare these guys with the Lôke-Khan. So they are quite different. These guys kind of resemble more... They kind of give off more of a ranger vibe, whereas these guys are more like mainline archers. Even though these guys have shorter range and actually are better in melee, so... The models don't really reflect their stats, so to speak. Oh, look at this officer guy. He looks like a mean son of a bitch. Look at him. Alright, who's next? The Runic Claw Legion. Our Spearman unit. I think Vanilla DAC only has one Golden Boy Spear unit. The, forgot their name, but they're pretty much the highest tier rune unit. And here we have a pretty basic spear unit, not a pike unit as you'd expect from them, though we'll get those later. Yeah, they look pretty cool, pretty basic. I love their shield design. Very, very nice. And then we have the Runic Fang Legion, a sword and board unit, which is very much new to Rhûn. They only have a sword and mace, a mace and board unit in vanilla. Same model as the other units, so we got a nice sense of uniformity here, just different weaponry. Which is quite alright. Alright, I think that's all the units. I don't want to batter down that gate, not at all. I want to blot out the sun and burn them more than the sun would. So I hope you are wearing sunscreen. You're freaking gonna need it, buddy. I'll put my spears in close reserve. Sword and board units ready to go. He's got the Serpent Elixir, which I think stuns them, right? Plus 150% own army combat effectiveness, which is really good. And 75% probability to stun enemy units for 35 seconds, which is also incredible. Oh, there we go! Look at that! We don't need no water, let the motherfuckers burn! Oh, those are some cute Variag nobles. It would be a shame if someone with armor piercing were to shoot them. Okay, we are in range of the towers, that's a little bit annoying. Because I think my guys have more range than I'm letting them on. So let's move you back a little bit. Oh yeah, sally them out, please. Please do. Oh, you can try charging him. I don't think they will, though. The AI loves to do that with their horse archers. Remember, these guys are AP, so they completely crush these guys. Oh, they are charging in. Interesting. He's going mental. That was a pretty good charge, I'll give you that. You killed a lot of my dudes. But you wasted your general, pretty much.
Victory is well within our grasp.
Of course it is. Time, our foe will surely. Look at these guys. They're turning them into bacon. Nice, crispy bacon. Look at that. Are my graphic settings all the way up? No! Come on, I want to enjoy this. In all its crispy, high definition. Okay, these guys are kicking my ass a little bit in melee. They are quite good. You're charging in? You're kind of a hesitant charge. I'm not sure why the AI didn't sally out, because this siege battle is turning more and more into a sally out. 7% for 20%, I'll take that. I think that's my general right here. I'm sure it'll be fine. If I lose my general in the first battle, I might just cry a little bit. How many times can I use that? I hope I can use it a lot. Okay, reinforcements are here. I'm surprised Kustik is still alive. That traitor! Traitorous dog, where is he? Is that him? I bet that's him. The general was dead, then their morale would already plummet. Oh well. They're merely postponing the inevitable. My Lôke-Khan are quite easily replaced. Especially in AGO. Smack him, come on! Ah, I can only use Serpent Elixir once. Yeah, you better run. Alright, shoot the hunters. Turn them into prey. Alright, general, pull back. Margos, get out of there. Let the spears deal with them. What are they called? The Claw Legion. You have to give me a couple of episodes to get used to their names. But by the end of this campaign, I'll be spitting out rhymes with them, the likes you've never seen before. Right. Burn their gate down! Burn them all! Let Melkor sort them out. Are you running? No. Did you miss the memo? You're not supposed to run, you're supposed to die. And the AI does not like my general. I wonder why. Could it be because I'm about to commit genocide on his people? Surely not. It's fine, he says to himself, with a small bit of doubt in his voice. Alright, kill that general, and then send in the legionnaires.
Our foe fights with horns made of clay. We are winning the battle.
Of course we are. 13% for 39%. I'm a little bit rusty, I'll admit that. But it could be going worse. Send in the legionnaires, come on! Kill the general. You guys are quite accurate, I like that. Look at him, he's getting shot in the back. Soon he'll be a nice crispy general. Another folly! For the dragon! Nice. I can actually smell it coming from my PC. That's the next step in gaming, right? We have VR, now we need smell reality, you know? When I light up a horse like a Christmas tree, I want to smell it. Burnt leather and just an awful smell. There we go.
The enemy general is slain.
Cleansed by fire.
Snakes fight without their head.
And now their morale will be like pretty awful. There we go, we got the walls. Not sure if that affects morale, but it damn right should. Yes, pile in my pretties, pile in! Look at those banners, I love it. In case you are new to the channel, perhaps, and you don't know, though I've mentioned it many, many times, Rhûn is my all-time favorite faction, both in the movie, the books, the games, any game that has Rhûn. I'm gonna friggin' love Rhûn. It's just their aesthetic pleases me very much. And DAC is no other, really. No exception. Though I must admit, the first time I downloaded Third Age to the War, which is like 10 years ago or even longer, the first faction I played was Lothlorien, not Rhûn. I think Rhûn was probably the second faction I played. A little bit of Izzy trivia for you. Can you stop circling around, buddy? That's really annoying. Makes it harder to barbecue you. Alright, instead of just ramming in there like a maniac, let's actually get some intelligent moving going on. You guys are pushing in. You guys, you're over there. Let's actually kind of circle around. Could also send in my archers. Okay, let's send in one runic fire legion, por favor. Get in there. Claw legion. You guys can go here. And the fang legion. Claw, fang. Fire. Names make sense, I suppose. Alright, fire legion. Could you fire on them guys in the back? Perfect. Yeah, our troops are really, really good. Like, Khandish raiders or hunters, they're alright, you know, 5-3-8, nothing to scoff at. But then you got our guys, 5-13, 7-11, the magic number. Alright. Horns made of clay.
We are winning the battle.
You're gonna get tired of that voice line by the end of this campaign, I can tell you that much. He says it a lot. Well, one they always say, that, I always remember that one. Our name lives on in marble and there lives on in sand, or something like that. I think they say it when you win the battle. Or maybe when you kill a general. You'll hear it, and then I'll be like, hey, it's the thing I said. There we go. Burn them! Burn them to a crisp! I wonder if it's possible to have, like, fire swords, where if you hit a unit... What if, like, this guy has, like, fire swords, they hit a guy, and then they turn on fire as well from a melee attack. That would be completely ludicrous, but maybe for, like, a Warhammer mod or something could work. Well, it's just a matter of dotting the I's and whatnot. Come on. Sandwich. And then let's get our Lôke-Khan to finish him off. I think they got the most kills. We'll check at the end of the battle, but they've done a lot of fighting. Make sure you don't toast your own units. Well, these guys are taking a bit of a beating. Khanish hunters are, they're not bad, like I said. They are pretty decent. I'm sure we'll replenish some troops. They're broken. Just like me. Alright. Alright, burn them all. Heal them all, take them down. That battle could have gone better. I lost more than I would like, but at the same time, it was quite a decent force we encountered, and we went in and took the settlements, and there we go. Let's see, 37%. 31, so we healed 6%. That's not bad. So the Lôke-Khan got the most kills, though it was kind of close with the Fang Legion and the Claw Legion. Well, these guys took a beating. Friendly fire was not too bad. Only 12 in total. No, never mind. 18 in total. That's not too bad. I expected quite a bit worse. Or better, I'm not sure what to call it. But there we go. Mattaram is ours, and that should hopefully help our funding a little bit. Blah! Nice. We just took a face full of dirt. Alright. Oh, we certainly have, my friend. What shall we do with the people? I think we'll start by Okay, there's barely anyone here. I thought there'd be a bit of a healthy population. 585, 569. Everyone's pretty much paying one coin to us, which is... could be worse. We're making money! Yes! Goal achieved. And we got a free unit of... Nomad Horsemen? I didn't know I could get that unit. Huh. They're a Khandish unit. And I can't get them yet. But they're quite alright. 5, 8, 10... 120% movement speed, they're quite good. They got a secondary attack of 4. Alright. Free upkeep when garrisoned, yeah, okay. Yeah, I'm not sure. Because I can't train them, right? No, I can't. Oh, wait, I can train them. Never mind. Didn't know that. Right. Well, you don't get free upkeep, so I'm going to send you over to. The garrison of Enmahadh has left.
Arktos.
I wonder where they went to. It's a little scary when they pull that off. Because you never know where they are. They could be anywhere. It's a pretty large region. So I think what I'll do is grab this entire army. Maybe some reinforcements from Mistrand. I don't think these guys are going to do anything. I'm just going to count on that. Well, actually, I got a bit of a better idea. Seeing as these guys are out in the open, a field battle seems quite likely, and I think I really want to get... Oh, they're 26 now. The Dragon Knights in the field. And this... Oh, this guy has no acumen. So he's a pretty bad governor. I was thinking of getting Khan Amdur to lead the army, but seeing as this guy has no governing skills whatsoever, I might just leave him as a general. Let's see, what is the difference? 569, 634. It's not huge. It's actually costing me more to got the guy. Yeah, no, never mind. It's costing me more to have the guy on the field anyway because of the upkeep. So, you are coming along. That unit alone could probably completely trample the entire rebel host. Alright, and let's get these guys on the field. We're making money, so it's about time we start losing money, eh? Alright, in Mattaram, kind of want to rush mines, because they're very, very good mines. But that's going to cost me so much, like I'm going to go bankrupt for a little bit, and then I'll get better after a while. I'm going to put it on low tax rate. No, it doesn't change the population growth. No, okay. But I could get the Mason's Hall first, that would save me quite a bit of cost and time. 20% of 5 is 1 turn, this is 2 turns, so it's effectively costing us 1 turn. And it's reducing it by 15%, which is about 500 coins. Yeah, that's worth it. We'll get that first, and then at Mistrand, we'll get... kind of want to say Green Exchange. Yeah, Green Exchange. Do I want separate units? No. Do I want a different spy? Possibly. But not yet, not yet. Alright, Diplomat, where art thou? Thou art here. What's your name? Zarthoshi.
As you will.
Hello, Norway.
I am a warrior.
Oh, you're looking quite happy these days. What do you call these sentinels? Flashbacks to my Darwinian campaign. Which was a lot of fun. But this one will be even better. Mark my words. If it's not, I'll give you a refund. Could you reach Enmahadh in the next turn? No, you can't. And again, there's currently no one there. I really don't like this AI doing that. It's so spooky. I mean, I do like that they're not too passive, but it's like a horror movie. You don't know where they're just lurking about. They could be around any corner, really. Oh, yes, we got a new guy here, a suitable husband. I will take him. Actually, I could plop him in Mattaram. And then... Wait, how bad are you at governing? You're better than the other guy.
Yes, noble master.
So I'll plop him there, and then... Lokheru Margos can join up at Enmahadh, as my squeaky chair continues to be a squeaky chair. Okay, I think that's a good way to go about it. Enmahadh also has access to gold here, so that's quite nice. Alright, if they attack me out here in the open, I might be screwed. Oh wait, I can get some Rovanian units. Ooh, and Privateer Cavalry. That changes things. These guys are actually pretty damn good. And these guys are ridiculously cheap. So I think I'll take them on as like throwaway units. It's costing me a lot of money, but then I don't have to worry about that rebel army that's lurking about. And it might give me enough momentum to capture Buramanarikas or push towards Elgair, possibly. Which also has no garrison anymore. Rhûbar, which I can't scout from here. And there's Wintirion, Captain Brego, it's Aragorn's horse. Interesting. I'm quite happy with that boat, but 100 upkeep is giving me quite a lot of information. Okay, if we take Enmahadh, that should be the Khandish. units back under our control, which I think gives me a custom general, if I'm not mistaken, which should be Variag Nobles. And it also allows me to train a lot of the Khandish units, which are quite good. Especially in vanilla DAC, where your basic starting units are quite bad. I mean, they're not orc trash, but they are quite bad. So getting those Khandish units fills them in quite nicely, but it's not really necessary right now. Talk to Dol Guldur. Oh, I love this mission, because then it tells me where they're at. So they're at Brown Boat. And my diplomat is all the way over here, so it's going to take him a while. It should be doable in 5 turns if I don't get blocked by every fucking settlement in the game. There we go. Thank you. The garrison came back. All mumbly jumbly. Okay, no problem. And actually, we got more than enough troops to take Enmahadh. And I don't want to take Burr Manarikis too fast, because that will put me at odds with Dorwinian. I'd rather take Elgair and Rhubarb first, I think. So I'm going to move these troops here, which is free upkeep. You go to Mattaram. Lôke-Khan Rhûkar, you go to the fort. They don't like me now. That's okay, low tax rate fixes that right up. Batu, you can now govern this place. Laying siege to that will be ours next turn. Let's see, there's Bur Ermanarikis. It has no garrison either. Lôke-Khan Rhûkar the Cunning. This guy looks scary. Dragon Wrath Swift Blades. Frighten nearby enemy infantry. 18 attack. That's insane. 7 charge and 25 defense. Holy cow. They are quite awesome. On the battlefield, they have been known to turn the odds of 10 to 1 engagements, and they are as feared as they are respected by the peoples of Rhûn. Morale unwavering. They get a bonus against friggin' elephants. What? How awesome are these guys? They just beat up elephants for fun. They like doing that. Insane. Alright, Eredluin and High Elves are friends. Don't care about that. That is quite literally the other side of the world for me. Hey, production priority is rank 7. We only have 2 settlements. Great. I'm half considering just getting some troops. They are quite expensive. They take 3 turns to get. The thing is, I need to have enough money to build my mines after this, and I might not. Yikes. Yeah, nah, I'm not gonna buy any troops right now. I need those mines. Maybe after taking Enmahadh, we'll see. I'm building rams, okay, perfect. A little bit scared to press the end turn, because I always feel like I'm forgetting something. But that's my favorite part of the campaigns, the start, because it's much easier to micromanage everything. If you're like at the end of a Reunited Kingdom campaign and you have like 60 settlements, it's impossible to put all your attention to every settlement and, you know, do things right. Whereas here, it's, I don't know, I like being a smaller faction. We won't be a small faction for long because we're going to expand quite rapidly. But factions that start with like 1 settlement, I love those. Perhaps that's also the reason why I love Rhûn so much. Alright, so we are at 3.6k, which is not enough for me to get my mines. No, wait, it is! Oh, right, we got 3 extra coins! Surely this guy gets a reduction in cost price or something, right? Because, let's see, well supplied, safe lands, Daritai clan member. Huh. I didn't expect the Mason's Halls to give us that big of a bonus. Okay, well, that's an instant buy. We're gonna go in the red. That's fine. I don't often go in the red and eye campaigns. I typically balance my budgets quite nicely, but sometimes you need a little bit of debt. Alright, we got Kursh over here with a very similar army as we just faced, if not the exact same. And he should have Variag Nobles as well. Yes. Yeah, I don't think there's anything special I need to do. We're just gonna shoot him. And then just walk in the city and take it. I mean, why change the strategy now? It worked before, it'll work again. We shall not fall or flee. Alright. Well, if this doesn't look like the exact same settlement, I don't know what is. But that army's looking quite bigger already. We got the Dragon Knights here, which look awesome. I just love the fact that they have these long spears and shields. They just look so heavily armored. Like, I thought nothing could be more cataphract than Loki and Azrim, and then these guys just show up with their black horses and gold barding, and ugh. Like, they even got, like, the details of the red, and ugh. Can't get over how good these guys look. The only thing they're missing, in my opinion, is, like, a plume. They got, like, some plumage here, but, like, a big dragon ornament on that head. That would make it even better. We got some nomad horsemen. They're very peaceful, they're nomad. We got some Rhovanian spearmen, which are quite trashy. Kind of turncoats, really. They really shouldn't be fighting alongside me. We got some Rhovanian hunters, which throw... Oh, they don't throw axes, they throw javis. I thought they threw axes based on their picture here. We got Privateer Cav, we got Privateer Axemen, which are AP. Which I think will do most of the heavy lifting and dying, because they're quite expensive. And quite easy to replace. Yeah. Sorry about that. Just had a bit of a coughing fit. Okay, let's just shoot these guys and then waltz in, knock down their gates. Be like, what's up, dude? Can the Lôke come up in your crib? And if they don't allow me in, I'll just insult their yee-ass haircut and be done with it. Drop that ram. Everyone else can just kind of stick in position. Oh, you guys are already in range. You got insane range. Come on, lads. Let's burn this place to the ground. If I can't have it, no one can. Look at that. Burning brighter than the sun itself. Look at that. Is that not beautiful? Is that not what you want to see when you click on my videos? Alright. These guys are going in ham. Let's send in the Dragon Knights, eh? Let's put your elite cavalry versus my elite cavalry. Let's do it. Oh, why do you always do this? I hate you guys. I just hate my archers. That's archerism, and you know it. Alright, but now we got the Dragon Knights. Soldiers of Rhûn! And these guys... They wish they never charged in that runic dragon legion. Okay, we got some burned corpses there. It's quite efficient if you think about it, because we don't need to do any post-battle cleanup. The corpses are already cremated. Don't have to worry about any diseases or, you know, vultures or any of that shit popping up. It's very clean. It's not great for the environment, but eh. Who cares about the environment, right? Yeah, they're going down fast. There we go. Capture him! Capture him! Capture that old woman! No! Shoot him! Shoot that fucking knobhead. I want to see that guy crispier than friggin' toast. And toastier than crisps. Look at him! What a beast. Alright, alright, you've earned my respect a little bit. Don't get comfortable though. Don't get comfy. That guy is made out of titanium or something. Alright. You guys, join your brethren in lighting these guys on fire. I can do this all day. Oh, never mind, they're activating towers. No, you can't do that. That's legal. Only I'm allowed to do that. Oh, fuck. He's charging in his cav. I'm charging in mine. The thing is, I rarely expect the AI to actually sally out. It's not a thing they do very often in vanilla Metsu, I feel like, unless they got a real big advantage. Usually when you're laying siege to a settlement and you attack the settlement, typically don't sally out. Anyway, let's enjoy... our dragon riders or dragon knights. Ooh, I love that horn sound effect. Sup, dudes? Y'all having fun? Huh? Is it fun to be a rebel? Rebel, rebel? David Bowie was right. You're all just rebels without a cause. Join me, it's not too late. Lay down your horses, but do it softly.
Will surely see this and lose heart.
Alright, shoot these knobheads. If they don't want to join me, then curse them. Alright, get the Privateer Axemen in there. I've paid good gold for these lads. Look at them. With their axes. Although they kind of look more like Bardiches. But Privateer Bardichemen, that's a bit of a mouthful. You know what else is a bit of a mouthful? Dragon Balls, I presume. Seen the size of those things on the show? Alright, they got some reserves in the middle there. These guys are having a bit of a cluster party. I never really pay much attention to their faces, but these guys actually have pretty high quality faces. The enemy have lost the walls. Send your these guys are definitely like lower quality faces. This guy have like a, he's got like a band-aid over his eye. There we go. The West will fall. I love that. I assume most of their voice lines come from the Battle of Middle-earth. Fire away, lads, fire away. Look at that. Oh, that was an actual charge. These guys are toast. Literally. Alright, in come the reserves. This guy's already getting gold chevrons. What a beast. He hasn't lost a single man yet. And I don't think they have multiple hit points, so it's not like he's losing hit points or anything. He's just not dying. Yeah, the only guy, the only unit that could stop these guys were the Variag Nobles, so that ship has very much sailed. Not to Valinor, but somewhere. And it ain't Mistrand either. They're already shaking. I would assume fire arrows cause morale damage. I know they do in Vanilla Mode 2, but I'm not sure. Because in this case, it's not a toggle, unlike in Vanilla Mode 2. It is just their baseline ammo, so to speak. Come on, let's kill them all with minimal commitment. Alright, in comes the next barrage of men. Give them a very warm welcome. And I do mean very, very warm. He's got the message. Look at this guy. Barely breaking a sweat. I mean, I assume he's breaking many sweats, wearing that armor and just having fire raining down above him. But metaphorical sweats, none. Alright, let's beat this up, because this is just, this is gruesome. I'm not sure if there's a thing like the Geneva Convention, like the Imladris Convention or something, but if there is, it is very much broken, tattered, burned, I guess. Only half the enemy force remains. We must pray they lose their will to fight. Geneva Convention, Mistrand's suggestion. Alright. Ah, yeah, their numbers are dropping. They're dropping faster than the panties of the average female Izzy viewer. Which is to say, not very fast, but still fast enough. Ooh, not sure what that sound was. I think my mouse quadruple clicked there. That's new. Come on, these guys were supposed to all die. I'm supposed to replace them with cheaper units. Barely lost anyone. And here I was claiming Margos was the ideal siege general, but this guy, pfft, you don't care. Yeah, they have no reserves pretty much. Alright, archers, stop fighting. I've become too well known for my friendly fire. So let's tone it down a little bit. Maybe let's get a general killed instead. Just kinda spiced it up. Hey, we lost the unit. We lost one guy. So in case there were any doubts, this is gonna be a bit of a power trip. This guy's already 3 gold chevrons. Just from that one battle. I shouldn't get too cocky though, watch me get him killed somehow. I can't die, he's immortal. He is a dragon, pretty much. He's a dragon on a horse.
Our men have taken control of the city.
I love how surprised he sounds. Where's that general? There he is! I'm gonna enjoy killing you, my friend. He is tough, I'll give him that. He has taken several blows and several arrows to the back. He's still going. Probably because he has a plume on his head. I'm telling you, we need plumes. Yeah, but it's not looking good. Was this guy Kustik or was that the previous guy? I can't remember.
Dead.
Yeah, it doesn't matter now.
Their doom
great victory.
They're already flailing the white banner.
Nectar.
Hello, France.
Let us drink of the most rare and glorious fruit.
Huzzah! Anyone left? Ah, there we go. 68 casualties. That's nothing. 5%. Look at these guys. What? It's insane numbers. Fire Legion not letting down either. Even the Axemen did quite alright. The Bardishmen. We mostly healed. We pretty much only healed Fire Legion, which is probably the unit that got charged in the beginning there. So that's quite alright. I can live with that. Enmahadh is ours, and that should be all the Khandish tribes, or at least the Runic Khandish tribes, back in our control. Boom! Another one bites the dust, quite literally. Give it to me. I love this music as well. I love the Eastern vibe. It's so cool, so perfect. Anyway, might as well occupy this one as well, right? Otherwise, it's going to take a long time to upgrade. Well, can't afford anything. I'm losing less money than I was before. I'm half considering getting rid of these mercenaries. Could also use them to take Burr Manarik, it's quite cheap. And there's also Varfest over here. But typically Mordor takes that one pretty early on. It's quite far as well, pretty close to the Black Gate. Just over here. No, let Mordor have it. It's more trade rights. Trade should be pretty good right now. We do border. I think we border Khand as well, right? Got the steps of the Wayne Rider. And this should be Khand land. I can't be wrong. Okay, I think that's all for our turn. Let's just move our diplomat. Mr. Zartoshi. That sounds like a brand of microwaves. Hey, what microwave have you got? I got a Zartoshi. Ooh, pretty cool. Yeah, we got the Mason's Hall in Mattaram. Cool. Wait, I already had that. Yeah, I bought the mines. Never mind. I'm easily impressed, it seems. So yeah, I could just... because these guys don't get any free upkeep whatsoever. I could just immediately move them out to Burr Manarikas. That will... that will put me at odds with Dorwinian though, which... then again... if we looked at this guy before, if that's kind of the unit that we'll get, then holy poop, I want that settlement. I think we're gonna do it. I'll leave behind a cheapskate unit, Ravanian Spearman. A next general I get that I don't need anywhere. I need to be careful, I can only afford 3 watchtowers. We'll plop over there. There it is. He has a crossing here, so I definitely want a watchtower there. The Runic Dragon Banner. Is that? Yeah, that's for the man I want to have as my next heir. Okay. Lokeruzosh. Jerk. Something I also want to do is get a watchtower near the sea. Looks quite pleasant. Oh, we already have one here. Ah, still. Never hurts to get a watchtower. Should also get some here, because I don't like black spotches. Right, press the end turn. It's probably the final turn for this episode. I don't want to make it too long. Just to give you guys a bit of an appetite for the cities. So you're all hyped for episode 2. I know I already am. It's not that I don't want to keep playing, trust me. I've done this campaign in one go at one point. 22 hours of non-stop DAC. That definitely... made me feel a little bit exhausted and tired of DAC. I need a week break from that. Alright, Khand pays tribute. With the taking of Mattaram and Enmahadh, the treacherous deserters have been broken, and should trouble neither us nor their former leader in the future. We now demand human tribute from Khand and its allies and their measly holdings, their warriors flocking to the banners of the Sun Dragon of Rhûn, riding in step beside our warriors. Every day, more and more volunteering clansmen bring their families and horses to our towns as well, filled with vain hopes to become servants of the Sun themselves. Among them is a Variag leader, who has been sent by Arkish as a token of his gratefulness. With him, he brings shadowy clouds from the south, the horizon nothing but gloomy and brooding dark. Khar's power is still fading. But not for much longer, my friend. So there we have Kursh. And he himself is Varag Nobles, which is hella useful. Some Khandish Raiders and Khandish Hunters. Which I could just send north with these guys and take Elgair. Even on the field, these guys would excel. It's going to cost me some money to get them on the move. It's going to be worth it. Yeah, if we get attacked, we'll be fine. Because Burr Manarikas is a region with only one settlement. There's Varfest. Lok Flagrim and Rvanian Spearmen. They're not that... Like, I could shoot them quite easily. So I'm almost considering sending an army to take Varfest. Oh, frick.
Is that what you want?
I think Mordor wants Varfest, seeing as he sent 3 out of 9 Nazgul, including the Witch King himself.
I will not waste words.
Yeah, they'll easily beat Captain Anakin. He doesn't have the high ground, so... He's gonna struggle. Although, these Albert... Like, these three units are hella scary, but then this is just a whole lot of crap. So they might... If they fail in taking Varfest, I would send the small army to try and take it myself. But for now, I'm going to lay siege to Burr Ermanarikis. Build all that. This army is going to move north towards Elgair. And that is a nice stepping stone for the next episode. So I hope you guys liked the episode. There's Naberk, I can see it now. Let me know what you thought in the comments. If you like the episodes, do consider giving it a like. It does help me out quite a bit. And yeah, next episode we should see the Battle of Burr Ermanarikis. We should also see us grab Elgair, possibly Rhûbar, and that's most of the kind of heartlands of Rhûn re-established. And then we can already, which is quite fast, look towards kicking Dorwinrim ass, which is going to be a hell of a lot of fun. So thanks for watching, thank you for your support already, and yeah, I'll see you soon for episode number 2.